Hi, welcome to Hand of the Plow. I'm Betty Newman, and I'm so glad you could join us today as we dig deep into God's Word. We'll be starting a new series today titled Our Blessed Hope, taken from the last four chapters of the book of Revelation. Hang in there. You won't want to miss this. Hi. Today we'll be starting a new series on Hand of the Plow. I've titled this series, Our Blessed Hope. In Titus 2, verses 11 through 13, Paul reminded Titus, and by extension us as well, that the grace of God has appeared, referring of course to Jesus, bringing salvation to all people, instructing us to deny ungodliness and worldly desires, and to live sensibly, righteously, and godly in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Christ Jesus. The last four chapters of Revelation, I believe, are a beautiful picture of that blessed hope. The word blessed is the Greek word makarios, which means literally happy. It means to be happy. Now, this is not happy like we use it today in our world, but this is a deep, abiding happiness, blessedness of the soul. It's the same word that Jesus used in the Beatitudes when he said, "Blessed are the poor in spirit." The Bible translates this blessed as happy, to be envied. The Amplified Version gives us an extended version of this, to be envied and spiritually prosperous with life, joy, and satisfaction in God's favor. Salvation regardless of their outward conditions. So this blessed hope that we have is a happy hope. The word hope, as it's used in Scripture, means a certainty. Now, when we use hope today in our culture, it's wishful thinking. I hope it doesn't rain on our picnic. But the word hope, as it's used in Scripture, is a noun. It is a certain thing. The world, as we see it today, has no hope. Just look around. But you and I do. It's our responsibility to know that and to share that with the others. It is our blessed hope. In this series, we'll cover the marriage feast of the Lamb, the second coming of Jesus, the millennial reign of Jesus, the great white throne judgment, which will also include what happens when we die, believers and non-believers as well. We'll look at the new heaven and the new earth, and along with the new Jerusalem, complete with the gates of pearl and the streets of gold. And we'll see just why we must share this with the world. In this first lesson, however, we will begin to lay the groundwork for the study by looking at chapter 1 of Revelation. Now, we have to start here because we need to know why the vision was given to John and why the book was written. We won't spend a lot of time on the details as we would if we were teaching through this chapter, because that would take several lessons. You know, I recently wrote a series of lessons on Revelation for a group of women in our area, and we spent the better part of a year getting through the book. We went verse by verse and at times word by word as we worked our way through it. It was intense. It was so intense at times that we compared it to labor pains. You remember in the Olivet Discourse found in Matthew chapters 24 and 25, as well as Mark 13 and Luke 21. When the disciples asked Jesus about the sign of His coming, the sign of His return, He said, as you may remember, that there will be wars and rumors of wars and all kinds of famines and pestilence and earthquakes. And then He said that all these things will just be the beginning of the birth pains. So all through this study, as it would get really intense, as the book of Revelation can get, we'd often talk about the birth pains, and then when it would get particularly intensive, we'd say, breathe deeply, just take a deep breath. So that was how we got through some of those very, very difficult times. But as interesting as this study was, when we finished it, I began to see how the last four chapters of Revelation, how important it is to know. And we need to know that, and we need to share that. So the important part of Revelation, in my opinion, is chapter 1, which lays the groundwork, and then chapters 19 through 22. If you believe in the pre-trib rapture, which is the rapture of the church before the tribulation, then everything between chapter 6 and 19 are more or less curiosity filling. I mean, it's important for us to know. It's important to study that. But as Christians, what we really need to know are chapters 19 through 22. And that's what I want to teach in this series. So let's get started. There are very practical reasons for studying this book, but an important one is the blessing. Actually, there are seven so-called Beatitudes in the book. Blessed are such and such. But the very first one comes in chapter 1, verse 3. There's one in chapter 1 and there's one in chapter 22, which comprise kind of a set of bookends for this book. But in chapter 1, verse 3, it says, "Blessed is he who reads, and those who hear the words of the prophecy, and those who heed the things written in it, for the time is near." And then in chapter 2, verse 7, as it closes out, Jesus says, "Blessed is he who heeds the words of the prophecy of this book." So the book of Revelation is the only book in the Bible that begins and ends with a blessing for the one who reads and hears it. But what is a revelation? What does revelation mean? The word for revelation is the Greek word apokalupos, which from where we get our word apocalypse. The word literally means an unveiling, literally to take the lid off. You know, it's like the end of the year when the new car models come out. Invariably, some commercial will have a car sitting there with a drape over it, and someone will ceremoniously pull the drape off. That's a revelation. That's an apokalupos. That's the unveiling that we want to see. It's not a scary word. It's used that way many times, but it isn't intended to be scary. It simply means to reveal, to uncover. This book is not a mystery. Why would we be given a blessing to study it if we were not able to understand what it says? We have that blessing. It is an unveiling. So let's begin by looking at verses 1 through 3, and we'll ask some questions. But the very first question that we need to ask is, who wrote the book? Well, for many of us, that's pretty obvious. It is John. But around 400 A.D., there began to be some dispute about which John wrote this book. Some said it wasn't written by the Apostle John, but by another John, one calling himself the Elder, which, by the way, I also believe is the Apostle John. But one of the arguments against John the Apostle being the writer is that you'll remember in the Gospel of John, John never mentions his own name. He doesn't mention his brother's name, and he doesn't even mention his mother's name. But in this book, in the book of Revelation, we see his bondservant John, or I John. Over and over again, we will get I John. And the reason I think that is because John is so overwhelmed that he is given this vision, he just can't keep from saying, "Can you believe it? Me, John, I got to see this. This is his attitude. This is happening to me." So we could read verse 1 this way, the second part of verse 1. "He," that is Jesus, "sent and communicated it," this revelation, "by his angel to his bondservant John." Which John? The John who testified to the Word of God and to the testimony of Jesus Christ, even all that he saw. Now, which John was that? Think about the Gospel of John. John 1:1. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." John, he says, "I bore witness to this testimony." The word testimony means evidence. And remember, John was there on the Mount of Transfiguration. He saw the evidence of Jesus' glory. So we're convinced, our most conservative scholars are convinced, that this book was written by the Apostle John. Verses 1 through 3 are called the prologue. The book begins by saying, "The revelation of Jesus Christ." The unveiling of Jesus Christ. He takes the cover off. We get to see Jesus in all his glory. You know, I once made a note in my Bible to the effect of the unveiling of Jesus doesn't actually begin until chapter 5, verse 5. Chapter 4 and chapter 5 lay the groundwork for that. But that's wrong. Actually, the unveiling begins with the very first word of this book. And if you study this book, as you go along, you'll see that. This book is the revelation of Jesus Christ. That does not mean the revelation that Jesus is giving, but the revelation about Jesus. Read verse 1 slowly. The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave to him to show to his, that is Jesus, bondservants. This is a gift. Although Jesus is not the one giving the revelation or doing the unveiling, he does share it by sending it to John by way of his angel. And by the way, when we get to chapter 22, I think we're going to find out who that angel is. But Jesus does this in order to show his followers and us, but he is not making it happen. He is sharing it, but it has been given to him. God gave it to him to share. He is the object or the person being revealed rather than the one doing the revealing. In verse 3, we find that the beatitude that we mentioned a moment ago, blessed is he who reads and those who hear the words of the prophecy and heed the things which are written in it, for the time is near. Those three words, reads, hears, heed, are in the present tense. No matter when this book is being read, 2,000 years ago, during the Dark Ages, last week, or 100 years from now, the words are for today. It is always today. Reading, hearing, and obeying the truth, not only in the book of Revelation, but the rest of the Bible, are to be a way of life for believers. Those who are also known as bondservants. So now look at verses 4 through 8. Who is the letter to? In verse 4, we find the salutation. And John basically says, from John to the seven churches in Asia. And then John says that the letter is actually from him who is and who was and who is to come. That's a reference that comes directly from Exodus chapter 3, verse 14, where we find God giving Moses his self-existent name, I am who I am. And also from Isaiah 41:4, where God says, I, the Lord, am the first and the last. This book is also from, or this letter is also from, the seven spirits who are before his throne. And that's found in Isaiah chapter 11, verse 2. And it's also from Jesus Christ. So it's from God, from the Holy Spirit, and from Jesus. We recognize this as the Trinity. Now, as you probably know, the word Trinity is not in the Bible, like the word rapture and the word millennium. They're not in the Bible, but the concept or the truth is everywhere. So how does John describe Jesus in verse 5a? Jesus is the faithful witness that establishes his credibility. He is the firstborn from the dead that establishes his superiority. And he is the ruler of the kings of the earth that establishes his sovereignty. We see that in Psalm 89 as well. And then John dedicates the book, verses 5 through 6. It is to him who loves us. The phrase is always present tense, and it indicates an ongoing relationship. Jesus loves us now and for always, and we know that he loves us. We have nothing to fear from this book. Many people fear reading this book. They don't even want to think about it. But there's nothing to fear in this book, or anywhere else in Scripture for that matter. And he has released us. That is past tense. It's a done deal. He has released us from our sin, the thing that separated us from God. And how did he do that? By his blood. And verse 6 says, he has made us to be a kingdom and priest. For what purpose? To serve his God and Father. And that is future and ongoing. Verses 7 and 8 then announce Jesus coming in the clouds, which is a quote from Daniel 7:13. You may remember in Acts chapter 1, when Jesus ascends into heaven, the disciples are all standing around him there on the Mount of Olives, and he ascends into heaven. And as they watch him go up into the clouds, an angel appears beside them, and the angel says, "Why are you looking up into the heavens? This one you have seen go will come back in the very same way." And we'll see that in another lesson. And then in verse 8, we read God's proclamation of being the Alpha and the Omega. And again, we see that He is the one who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. And then verses 9 through 16 describe the event that John experienced. Up until verse 9, there's been nothing unusual about John's words. He's just relating what is going to be coming up, what he saw, where he was, the prologue or the introduction of the book. It just stated more or less matter-of-factly how the book came to be. But beginning with verse 10, everything changes, and we're given a glimpse of what is to come in the rest of the book. So to set the stage for this event, we need to have a little bit of background. We find first that John the Apostle is a very old man. He is the last of the disciples who is in exile on the island of Patmos. All the other disciples have died. They've been martyred in one shape or another. John is exiled to the island of Patmos for preaching of Jesus. It was Sunday. It was the Lord's Day. And John was more or less minding his own business, worshiping God in his own way, however one might be able to worship God while they're in exile. But suddenly he hears behind him a loud voice. And he said it was like the sound of a trumpet. Now, it didn't sound like a horn, but it was like a trumpet call. In the Civil War particularly, there were different trumpet calls as how they conveyed messages to the troops. So this trumpet call had a distinct sound to it. But John recognizes this voice. And the voice told him to write in a book what you see and send it to the seven churches. Now note it says, send it to the churches. All of these letters, I believe, were sent to all of the churches. I don't think there were individual letters sent to the individual churches. I think the entire book as a whole, including the visions, are compiled in a letter and sent to each one of the churches. And we'll see that at the end of chapter 22. This entire vision was compiled into one book and preserved. And we will see that chapter 22 connects back with chapter 1. At this point, we could ask, why these seven churches? Why did they pick these seven? And that's a whole lesson in itself. The book of Revelation was written around AD 95 to 100, and there were well over 100 churches in the region at that time. Why these seven? Well, there are three ways of looking at this. First of all, there's what's called the contemporary view. This says that Christ had a distinct and direct message for each one of these churches existing. That's one view. Another view is called the composite view. That says that these messages are to be applied to churches across the centuries. That's another view. And finally, there is the church age view. This teaches that each one of these churches represents the church eras through the centuries. Actually, I believe in all three. I believe Jesus did have a message for these specific churches. He has a message for our churches today, and He also had a message for the church ages corresponding down through history. I have a chart on that. Email me, and I'll be happy to send it to you. But there's something else that I learned. I said that Jesus' unveiling began in chapter 5. That's what I used to think. But now I see in each one of these churches, Jesus is unveiled a little more on top. As you read through them, you begin to see more and more about Jesus. Each one of the unveilings builds on the one before it. If you look on a map, these seven churches geographically fit the route that a mail carrier would go from Ephesus to Smyrna to Pergamum to Thyatira to Sardis, Philadelphia, and then finally to Laodicea. And they fit the church age. The apostolic church, the persecuted church, the compromising church, the dark ages, the Reformation, the Great Awakening, and finally the worldly or the lukewarm church era. John then describes what he saw as he slowly turned around and encountered the resurrected and glorified Jesus. And we don't have time to get into this description in depth. But if you read these verses, verses 12 through 16, you can see what John saw. He saw a voice. He saw the voice, the one who was speaking to him. And he saw seven golden lampstands. In the middle of the lampstands was one like a son of God, clothed in a robe, reaching to the feet, and girded across his breast with a golden girdle. His head, on his hair was white as wool. His eyes were like a flame of fire. His feet were burnished bronze when it was caused to glow in the furnace. His voice was like the sound of many waters. And in his right hand, he held seven stars, and out of his mouth came a sharp, two-edged sword. His face was like the shining sun in its strength. Think about it. Have you ever thought about Jesus in those terms? We see pictures of Jesus with the children, or Jesus in the boat, or Jesus with the fishermen. But we need to see Jesus in this way as well. So how did John respond? Verse 17 tells us, John said, "And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as a dead man." Can you imagine? John, when he saw him, he fell. And what did Jesus do? Jesus came and he laid his right hand upon John and he said, "Don't be afraid." What do we do when we're afraid? Are we fearful of the things that this book has to say? Are we fearful when we read these descriptions of Jesus in his judgment? We should not be fearful. Jesus goes on to give John an instruction, which becomes the outline for the book. Verse 19 says, "Write therefore the things which you have seen, and the things which are, and the things which shall take place after these things." The things which you have seen are the things that we read about here in chapter 1. As John is there on the island of Patmos, he sees these things take place, the things which you have seen. The things which are found in chapters 2 through 3, as Jesus has a message for each one of these churches in their era. Each one of these churches he will unveil himself to. Each one of these churches he will give a word of commendation, except one. Each one of these churches will be told of the things that they are doing right and the things that they are doing wrong. Each one of these churches will be told how to change, how to do the things that they need to do. These covers chapters, and then the things which will take place after these things cover chapters 4 through 22. In these chapters, we will see Jesus unveiled in a way that we have never seen him before. We will see John being caught up into the heavenly throne room in chapter 4. In chapter 5, we will see the scroll being given to Jesus and the lamb standing as if it was slain. Chapter 6, the four horses of the apocalypse, and we'll talk about that in another lesson. But each one of these things we will see as John is... Each one of these are revealed to John. In our next lesson, we will jump all the way to chapter 19, and we will begin our study of our blessed hope. In chapter 19, after the tribulation is over, the first thing we find is the marriage feast of the Lamb. Then we will talk about Jesus returning to earth to usher in the millennial kingdom. We'll be breaking chapter 19 down into two separate lessons. But as you read that chapter, I encourage you, after you watch this teaching, read that chapter and write down your questions. If you would like, email them to us, and we would be glad to make sure we cover and answer your questions. Read chapter 19. Feel free to send us a note and to write to us as things that you have questions about this. But as we see Jesus unveiled, as John saw him the first time, with his hair white as wool, with his eyes a flame of fire, with his feet burnished bronze, with his voice like the sound of many waters, with his right hand the seven stars and the sharp two-edged sword. We see that all throughout Scripture. You will be amazed to see that as we study this book, There are no direct quotes from the Old Testament, but there are hundreds of allusions. There are hundreds of inferences and teaching. The prophecies of the Old Testament come through. The teaching of the Old Testament comes through. And we see the Jewish people being brought again into a belief and into an understanding of these last days. I will do my best to answer any questions that you have. It's interesting, in our East Knox Women's Bible Study group, we at the end of our study year, we have a time that we call Ask Betty. And you'll be amazed at some of the questions that are asked. We have a lot of fun and a lot of fellowship in that. But we share these questions. Don't be afraid to share questions that you have. Don't think that they're not good enough. If it's a question for you, then we will look at that. As I said, next time we will come to chapter 19, and we will see this revelation of Jesus Christ. We will see how the apocalypse, the battle of Armageddon is over at that time. We will see how Jesus appears at the marriage feast of the Lamb. I hope you will join with us as we continue this study. As we come to chapter 19, just to give you a brief preview, we will hear John say, "After these things, I heard, as it were, the voice of a loud multitude in heaven." We'll find out who that multitude is. Who are the angels that are there? Who are the saints? Who are the tribulation saints? Who are the 24 elders? As we come to this time, We will study in depth. As we learn in this, we've seen, I went through this rather quickly, not being exactly sure how to bring this down to the end. So I hope you will bear with me as we learn how to time this and make this just a very real time of teaching. I want you to feel comfortable, and I want you to feel at home as we share. I want to teach. I love this scripture, I love the word, and I love to share what God has given me the opportunity to do. Just briefly at the last of this, the mystery of the seven stars that Jesus saw in his hand, the mystery of the seven golden lampstands, the seven stars are the angels, the seven lampstands, the angels are the seven churches, and the lampstands are the seven churches. The angels of the churches and the churches themselves. As we close out this time, I just want to say, may God bless your time of study. In Jesus' name, amen.